Hi everyone, I'm Abhishek Lamba. I am the co-designer of Dasan Azadi. And today I have with me Hamza. Hamza is a writer, a researcher, a singer, and a dancer. That's how she introduced herself to me. And she has studied contemporary history from King's College. And she is also the author of our South Asian Freedom Struggle campaign. And I'm so excited to have her here with us today. And we'll just be talking about the campaign, Azadi, colonialism, and everything else. So the first thing I wanted to ask you was, what attracted you towards studying the South Asian freedom struggle? What got you to this subject? Obviously, apart from 300 years of colonialism or whatever. Yeah.
So I've always been interested in history. It's just the areas of history that have changed over the years. It started with my first interest was ancient civilizations, Indus Valley, back in school. And back then, so in school, at least for me, we studied history as isolated events, which is like one event after another, and never about like how this happened, rather this happened, and these are the facts, and on to the next one. And then from there, it was more so, I think, once I reached college, where we were asked to like discuss things, we were asked to critique things. I think that's when I was really invested and interested. And so the main difference for me was in school, we would study history and we would study the freedom movement, as everyone does. But it was only once I reached the college level that we started studying about colonization as a process. And not only in terms of India and this Indian subcontinent, but European powers, and they are the whole thing. So that's where it kind of started. And then from there, it was like a combination of things. I was also studying political thought at that point. I was also studying very briefly a little bit of Indian philosophy, which is like the Nyaya and Sankhya schools of thought. But I was looking at it all through a lens of history. So it's like a really like a long shot thing, but I think understanding processes of how people were mobilized is what really got me interested. And then more specifically in India or South Asian history was much later, like when I was doing my master's. And that's kind of like, it's very hard to explain how I landed there, because it was just like you jumped off one thing to another, and I kind of ended up like doing my thesis and my main research in that. But it's more like trying to understand ideologies is where the interest kind of really started, and to try and like reason out, understand the logic, or to critique things is where it kind of started. Yeah.
Awesome. So just to lead in from that, I mean, I don't know about you, but do you have any family history with colonialism? Like, do you know where your ancestors were at the time of colonialism, and were they affected by partition and all the events that happened then?
Not the partition. I mean, I don't know if this really counts, but I mean, I don't have a surname. But that was more of a social reform movement rather than a political reform movement. But it's all interlinked, especially when you read like Indian history. They all kind of, they ran parallelly. So that's probably one thing that's passed down generations. That's something I don't have a surname. I don't plan on having one anytime soon. So that is something that's there as a personal like connection with it. But it's very hard. But at the same time, it's kind of hard to pinpoint. There are obviously, like, it's always reflected in the way we do things, decolonization. So there are a lot of, like, residual effects of it in our generation, but a direct connect would probably be the fact that I don't have a surname.
Yeah. Great. So now that you've brought it up, I wanted to ask, in what ways do you think we're still colonized today? I mean, we talk of post-colonialism, and it's a heavy word to throw around, but
yeah.
Where do you feel like we still carry our scars of colonialism?
So I think I'm saying a lot of soap, but anyway. So colonization is such a long drawn process. Like you said, here itself, in the Indian subcontinent, over 300 years. And we weren't colonized only by the British. We were colonized by multiple European nations. And the effect, and also it didn't have like a standard process. It was not like this is the process of colonization. It had phases, and it changed with time. The agenda and the excuses given for it changed with time. And So now it's going to take some, it's more of like, rather than saying specific things like, you know, we should go back to like, I don't know, the 17th century and start wearing dhotis and salwar kameez. It's not that. I mean, fashion is like a soft power at best. Mm. It's not that. It's more of like how we view things, how we, like the language that we speak. Mm. There is a lot of like residual in terms of the just how we conduct ourselves. That's kind of there even in our generation, even though we have nothing to do. We were not born during that time. So that's there. But it's very hard to like really pinpoint. It's also hard to measure the degree of decolonization because we can't measure colonization itself. Mm. It's also because especially like the not the degree but the execution of this process was different across different parts of the Indian subcontinent. Mm. Like there we had like princely states and then we had presidencies and then everybody was impacted very differently. Everybody's experiences were so varied. So it's very hard to really pinpoint and say. But if in a yes or no, it's definitely a yes. Like we are definitely, we still have a like a strong mindset. And even apart from that, I mean, that's like a on an India level. So even apart from that, if we like do a more macro analysis, there are still regions and territories which are recognized by UN. I think there are around 17 territories which are recognized as non-self-government, where countries like UK, US, France have administrative powers. So, I mean, I don't think we're really done with colonization, let alone decolonization. So it's like a, it's going to take a long time to change our mindset, change the lens with which we view things. And, but it's, I think it reflects a lot in, not maximum, because I'm not an expert in that sense, but it reflects a lot in the language that we use. That's also probably because we read a lot of books and a lot of like consumed a lot of information that was written by the British. So more specifically, if we, I don't know, it's might be a colonial mindset and it's also incorporation of like other variables. But there was like this obsession that the British had with the need to like categorize Indians and associate characteristics to them. So we tend to still think because we associate characteristics with certain, you can say communities. And I mean, even if you look up documents from that time period where they conducted census and stuff, it's like they had an obsession, like everybody had to be labeled. And we also have literally catalogs and like clay figurines of this Indian person belonging to this community. And these are the characteristics. And it's like it's like very specific pinpoint characteristics from like eye shape to hair color to everything. So they like there is like a real like that's probably one strong mindset that we need to change. Like we tend to do that.
You brought up language, and so like I remember in school we'd read Rudyard Kipling a lot. And we would celebrate Rudyard Kipling, not just read. We would celebrate Rudyard Kipling. And then I grew a bit older and I discovered this thing called Google. And I found out that, no, he hated us. He colonized us. And it was very shocking to me that, like, sometimes I worry that as Indians, we are not even able to tell our own stories really well. Yeah, but it's a very interesting, it's a very nice point to bring up about language. So the Indian freedom struggle story is centered around cis upper caste men. And if you had the chance, and with Azadi you did, how would you reframe our story?
Yeah, so a lot of our history that's written was written by, I mean, literally there were people hired with, who moved around with freedom writer of, freedom fighters, and they wrote down our history at the time because they obviously knew they were doing something historical. And so a lot of history that we read, accounts that we read, are based off that. So like you said, they have a very top-down narrative where it comes from like freedom fighters who happen to be these socio-economically privileged class in general. So it's very, so to change that perspective would be to really change everything that we study. We have to include, it's not like there weren't writers who wrote about the subaltern history, or that people who didn't write, who wrote like very realistic experiences that they had. but they are just never, they're not given the same exposure as, say, we give to like notes and accounts by these other writers. So if we really want to change that, like very specifically speaking, and honestly speaking, we'll have to change, like incorporate those into like our school syllabuses. But it's not a one person, like it's very hard. It's like, it's not a switch. Like, it's not like we can just change it. Like, it's going to take a lot of conversation, a lot of criticizing, a lot of like being able to accept criticism, because it's also a very sensitive topic. We don't like to hear if somebody says, you know, this person who we have really admired did these bad things, and this is what they did wrong, and they use this as propaganda or whatnot. But we need to get used to it, and we tend to have, especially, maybe it's, I don't know if it's only in India, but especially when it comes to things like freedom movements, we have a very villain hero kind of narrative, and that needs to change. And so yeah, we need to encourage more reading, more research in subaltern history, and more specifically in that oral history, which is usually left out, which is where we find, like, for example, a lot of stories of, say, for example, partition. These are very trauma-induced memories for a lot. So they are never really put into account. So if we really want to include that, it's only through oral history, because nobody's really made an account of it. There are also a lot of events maybe in history that people would want to like erase out, because they are not very nice, and they don't really add value to the whole narrative. So if we need to like just, yeah, so oral history, subaltern history would be two ways to really change that. And more specifically, really question, like get used to questioning and critiquing our own history, and why this person did this, why, you know, getting used to hearing negative things about, say, people we really admired. So that would be a good way to start.
Yeah, we need to maybe break that cycle of bhakti that we have here for our leaders. And bhakti, for those who may not know, means worship. It's, I think that's a good enough translation for it. So on that note, I wanted to ask, is there any sort of media about revolution, freedom struggles, colonialism that you'd like to recommend? And this could be from films, books, TV shows, games even. So are there any recommendations?
There are quite a few. I'm going to tell what I can remember.
Yeah.
Early Indians is a book by Tony Joseph, which is a really good read. It's not really connected to modern Indian subcontinent and modern, like the Indian state as such. But for people who have a very like, this is our ancestry kind of understanding of, especially like in India, we have a very like, this is our ancestry, this is our lineage. It's very concrete, evidence driven book that tells us, you know, like everyone's already mixed up. Like there's no, like, you know, you can't have that mindset anymore. And it's like, it treats history like a science, so which is why it's a really interesting read. And this might be not again related to revolution. I don't know if I don't think I've read a lot recently with regards to revolution.
Anything, even if it's in the, you know.
Films. I can tell you documentaries. I've been seeing them lately.
Yeah.
So there's White Helmets, which is a really good documentary. It makes you question modern day feudalism. I don't know if you can call it colonialism, but it makes you question who really has the power. And, you know, we tend to believe we live in a modern world, you know, so in a democratic world where we have the UN and everybody has human rights and stuff. So that's an interesting one. And again, in terms of like identity and stuff, other documentaries would be MIA Matangi, which is based on this musician. Musician's the artist story, so that's a good one. Then there's this documentary called Another New Story. I don't know where you can see it, but it's like, if anyone can, they should. It's a documentary about reporters covering refugees. So that's one. And there's also one called The Cleaners, which is about these companies that work pretty much like an undercover company that work with bigger corporations, like say Facebook. And for example, like when we say, you know, we report something that's inhumane, or like, you know, something crazy, that a video that we see on Facebook, then these people have to manually go through them, see those videos and decide if they should be deleted or they can go, you know, they are fine to be on the internet. But it's like a pretty intense job, and they are not really given counseling. They are not, they are made to work. They can't tell anyone they work for these companies. So it's almost like a violation of human rights kind of a thing. So that's a very, that's also good. Yeah, those are, yeah, those are my recommendations.
Great. Thanks. We'll find links for them and we'll put them in the description box. And a last question. So thousands of people are going to play Shasan Azadi, and a lot of them won't be from the subcontinent. A lot of them wouldn't have lived through our history the way we have. Is there anything you'd like to say to them before they play through the South Asian freedom struggle?
I think if anybody is remotely interested in history or in politics as a subject, they would definitely enjoy this game. And Indian history in general is so layered, and there's so much that happened just in that colonization period. Also, like, it's very likely that you would have some sort of history connected to the subcontinent, because we were not colonized by one country, like I said. And even apart from that, we have this very, like, really connected history, be it even with nations in Middle East, be it Europe, be it anywhere. So it's a very interesting, like, series of events that happen. So if anybody's even remotely interested, they should definitely, they would definitely enjoy the game. And more importantly, I think the game really questions and helps bring to light different perspectives. We tend to have, like, how do I say this? We tend to have a very Eurocentric vision of the world. So this game will try and kind of change that, where it's not so, like, you know, yeah. So it's definitely, like, if somebody's interested in, like, even remotely with politics and history, would definitely like the game.
Great. So if you want to get your hands on the game, you can go to www.byshasan.com. Again, we'll link it in the description below. And that's all. Thanks for dropping by, Hamza. It was so nice to hear from you and just discuss all of art history. And I call it art history because it does feel personal, and it feels personal. It felt very personal to me making this game, as I'm sure it did to you writing for this game. So it was great having you. Thank you for coming, and hopefully we'll see each other soon. Bye.
Bye.